Good evening and welcome to Writers on Writing. I'm your host, Brenda M. Greene, and you are in the studios of Megar Evers College over the airways of WNYE 91.5 FM. I am Executive Director of the Center for Black Literature at Megar Evers College and Director of the National Black Writers Conference. Writers on Writing comes to you every Sunday and gives you, our listening audience, an opportunity to hear writers from the African diaspora talk about their work, their lives, and their craft. And I am very pleased to have with me in the studio this evening the poet, playwright, novelist, young poet, playwright, novelist, Zetta Elliott. Welcome, Zetta.
Thank you, Dr. Greene. It's nice to be here.
Oh, you're welcome. And it's really, really nice to have you in the studio and to have our audience hear your story. I want to thank our engineer, Fritz Richardson, for always being there. And the music you heard at the beginning was Gary Bartz. I've known Rivers by Langston Hughes, and Gary Bartz had an opportunity to play with the National Black Writers Conference.
Right.
It was really, really exciting. But now to share some information about our guest, Zetta Elliott. Zetta Elliott, who was born and raised in Canada and who now lives in Brooklyn, is, as I said, a poet, a novelist, and a playwright. Her most recent book is A Wish After Midnight, a novel. She has also published a children's book, Bird, which won a number of awards, including the Ertzer Jack Keats Book Award, a notable book for the Association for Library Services, and the Coretta Scott King Award. Zetta Elliott has been published in a number of anthologies, including the Cave Canem anthology, The Ringing Ear, Black Poets Lean South, and Check the Rhythm, an anthology of female poets and MCs. She, as I said, is also a playwright. Her first play, Nothing But a Woman, was a finalist in the Chicago Dramatist's Many Voices Project. Her fourth full-length play, Connor's Boy, was staged as part of two play festivals in Cleveland, Ohio, as part of the Karamu House's R. Joyce Whitley Festival of New Plays. So, Zetta Elliott has been very hard living the life of the writer,
mm-hmm.
and also doing essays, a number of essays, scholarly, literary essays.
Right, kind of a hybrid scholarly essay, personal essay, combining my personal experience and perspective as an immigrant, as a feminist, as an artist, with my academic training in Black feminist cultural criticism.
Great. Very, very interesting background. So why don't you share, I've given the biographical information, why don't you share with our audience how you began your writing life and to really live the life of the mind?
Wow. Well, I think I've always been interested in stories from the time that I was quite a young child. Both of my parents are school teachers, and so education and reading were things that were highly valued in my home. My parents were not very talkative when it came to their personal histories, but my grandparents had all kinds of stories to tell about their ancestors. My maternal grandmother in particular believed that we were connected to Bishop Richard Allen, founder of the AME Church in Philadelphia. So she always told stories about our African-American ancestors purchasing their freedom, coming to Ontario in the 1820s. And I grew up with those narratives, but didn't really understand how they connected to me personally. It really wasn't until, I would say, graduate school that I started to understand what it meant to be self-reflexive, to be able to theorize your own experience. And that actually is something that I really try to impart to my students when I'm teaching, that, you know, it's important to reflect upon your life, to understand your motivations, why you are where you are, why you do what you do. I'm an immigrant. I came to the United States in 1994 because my father's a U.S. citizen. He kind of gave up on Canada, and I guess I did too, in a way, and really found my voice here in Brooklyn. So I tend to write mostly about the city, even though I didn't grow up in a dense urban environment. Brooklyn, I just love it. It's my heart, and almost all of my stories are set here. And right now I'm trying to find, I guess, a balance between doing kind of untraditional, non-traditional scholarly work, but also existing as an artist, as someone who writes for a living.
Okay. And one of the interesting things about your background, as I was just sharing with the audience, the range of genres you've written in, mm-hmm. is that you do write in a range of genres. How did you come to do that? Why are you motivated to move from children's books to playwrights to scholar?
Right.
What's motivating you to write from all these different spaces?
Right. Well, I would like to say that I had a strategy and it's just going according to plan, but it kind of evolves organically, I think. I initially, when I started writing around the age of 15, I thought I was a novelist for sure. And I started my first novel, and it was absolutely horrible. And I think the next few things I wrote over the next few years were obviously essays for school, but short stories. And then I thought, oh, I'm a short story writer. And then when I started graduate school, you know, it can be kind of difficult to separate your artistic voice from the theoretical writing that you're required to do in the academy. And so I actually ended up leaving graduate school, and I wrote my first novel. And that really is, novel writing is just... It's really, a lot of it is about stamina. Can you maintain, can you sustain your voice? Can you maintain the narrative for as long as it takes to complete a full book? And once I had done that, I really thought I had arrived. I was querying agents and editors, and I was getting such an enthusiastic response. I thought, oh, I've made it. Mm-hmm. I crossed the finish line. And then after 6 months of not getting an offer on the book, I realized that I had to keep writing. Then if I was going to be a writer, it wasn't going to be about publishing. It was going to be about finishing my projects. And I was teaching all the while that I was in graduate school at NYU. I was teaching part-time in after-school programs and community centers. And I was actually teaching at the Frederick Douglass Creative Arts Center, and I was teaching creative writing in their after-school program. And one of the genres that I was teaching was the picture book. And I figured in order to show the kids how to write a picture book, I needed to write one. So that was actually how I started writing for children. I wrote a dummy kind of picture book to show them, and they loved it. And then I had a little girl in my class who needed a story about children who have mothers who are incarcerated, and I couldn't find a book for her in the library or in bookstores, and so I wrote it for her. And I ended up kind of on a run, I guess. I was supposed to be writing my dissertation. I went back to graduate school. And I was in Ohio. I had a fellowship to finish my dissertation, but 9/11 had happened. And I found it, my dissertation is on racial violence, and I found it really difficult to kind of focus on writing about trauma when we were living through it. Mm-hmm. And so I wrote stories for children. And I think that's actually therapeutic for adults in a way, because it simplifies things. You can really break things down and reduce complex ideas to something that's very short and concise, but also beautiful, I think. And so I wrote... And the time that I was out there, I think I completed about 20 picture book stories.
Oh, my goodness.
And then I realized that I had started A Wish After Midnight before 9/11 in 2001 and decided I was going to finish it. So by the time I left Ohio, I had gotten the bulk of the book written, and I came back to Brooklyn, and I was living with my dad, and I finished the novel. And then I started the sequel, but my father had cancer at the time, and I was kind of his primary caregiver, and so I stopped writing. And then after my father passed away, I was kind of at a crossroads and started writing plays. I think there are moments when certain genres lend themselves to what you're going through in your life. And I think voice was really important to me at that moment when I lost my father. And there wasn't a lot of conversation in my family, as there tends not to be. And so I started dramatic writing because I was drawn to it because of the dialogue. You could have people say things that they maybe weren't willing to say in real life. And so often we say to one another, don't even go there. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know what? Sometimes we need to go there. So I finished my first play and then went to Africa for a little while. And
what part of Africa?
I was in Djibouti in East Africa. It's across the sea from Yemen. And I thought I was going to be there for a year. They were starting a university, and they wanted PhDs to go over and teach in their university. And then we got there and found out there was no university.
Oh.
So what they actually needed were ESL teachers, and I'm not trained to do that. And they didn't have materials ready. It was just a lot of miscommunication, unfortunately, between the sponsoring organization in the country. But after 5 weeks in Africa, I needed to come back. I had sublet my apartment in Brooklyn, and so I went back to Toronto and lived with my mother for 6 months. And in order to keep my sanity, started writing a memoir and wrote a travel memoir, which ended up being kind of a meditation on my relationship with my father and the months leading up to his death and the difficulty of dealing with his cancer. And so a memoir was clearly what I needed to write at that moment. And I wrote it very quickly in about 5 weeks, and then started another novel about my ancestors living in Canada, but was really frustrated with the way things were progressing for me as an artist in Canada. So came back to the United States and accepted a job in Louisiana. And as I got to Baton Rouge, Louisiana, 3 weeks later, Katrina hit.
So what is happening in your life? You're being called to write.
The thing is, I know that some people, because I had another job offer in Canada and I rejected it in favor of the job in Louisiana. And I know some people really felt sorry for me. They were like, oh, if you'd only taken the job in Canada. But I was really grateful to have been in Louisiana at that particular moment. I mean, it was intense and it was traumatic. But, you know, Baton Rouge wasn't hit by Katrina. So we were okay. We didn't sustain that much damage. And then we were there for the students that had to evacuate from New Orleans. So I had a classroom that was a real mix of students from New Orleans who felt they were more progressive and students from Baton Rouge who felt they were progressive and students from East Louisiana and North Louisiana who were just trying to be in a more kind of diverse and progressive space. And it was really intense. And I started writing plays. And wrote about 20 plays.
Okay, are any of your plays related to those themes?
The first play that I wrote was based on a situation in my family, and it's actually the only play I've written that's set in Canada, and the second play I wrote was about Katrina. Okay. Yeah, it was kind of a speculative fiction, magical realism type thing about a takeoff on The Wizard of Oz. A young woman is picked up by a hurricane, except she's African-American, and she lands on a plantation along the Mississippi River in Louisiana, and she can't tell if it's the contemporary moment and these are docents and people acting in costumes, or are these actually, because you know that many of the plantations along the Mississippi River in Louisiana were still occupied. The slave shacks were still lived in by blacks up until the late 70s. So playwriting, it wasn't appropriate for me to say certain things that I was observing, you know, during Katrina and its aftermath, but I found that I could say things in my plays.
Yeah, and that's what story does, and that's what literature does. Mm-hmm. It's kind of interesting that you said it was hard to write in the creative voice when you were working on your dissertation. And I think that many people who go the other way, you know, one of the things I struggled with is getting that dissertation voice and that academic voice out of my writing.
Yes.
And finding my voice.
Yes.
And but you ended up going back to the other way. And would you say that your writing, is that part of why your academic writing has a pretty strong voice in it?
I think so. I mean, I think one of the things that African-American scholars have really contributed to academic writing is the insistence that the personal matters, right? Feminists, we already know, the personal is political, but this idea of objective neutrality, you know, the black public intellectuals that I was reading in graduate school, Trisha Rose and Robin Kelly and Michael Eric Dyson, those types of people, you know, they weren't trying to be invisible while they wrote. You know, it was okay to be fully present, to acknowledge, you know, the location that you were occupying. And so I found that really empowering to be able to write an essay about Strange Fruit, Billie Holiday's rendition of Strange Fruit, and to start it off by saying, on my birthday, I went to see Cassandra Wilson at St. Anne's Cathedral, and mm-hmm. the first song she sang was Strange Fruit. You know, to be able to theorize your own experience, but the jargon that you use for academic writing, for theorizing, that can become a kind of obstruction. And in a way, it indicates a kind of failure of imagination, because if you can only use one set of terms, you're not using your imagination enough.
Failure or limit?
Limit.
Okay.
Yeah. So mm-hmm. But it means you have to push beyond mm-hmm. that right. limit. And I think that's what the essays that I write now, I feel as though I have greater fluidity and I have less inhibition in what I'm writing, because I'm not trying to pretend to be objective and neutral. I'm not pretending mm-hmm. to be an expert mm-hmm. on all things. But I do have a particular kind of training. I have a particular kind of viewpoint, and I try to bring that to whatever I write now.
Right. And that's a nice segue for A Wish After Midnight, mm-hmm. which you label under the genre of Afro-urban magic.
Yes.
Talk a little bit about it, because I had not heard that before.
Well, I think I coined that, but okay. I may be mistaken. And if I am, someone should call me on it. Of course, there are lots of other speculative fiction writers, African-American writers, who have been trying to work out these ideas of how to incorporate a certain kind of hybridity into your writing. And for me, Afro-urban magic is a way of using African retentions, African cultural practices that we find in the diaspora, so that we have in New York City such a fusion of African diasporic communities. You have some people who might be practicing Santeria, you have some people who might be practicing voodoo, you have Baptist churches, you have all kinds of different customs and beliefs, many of which trace their roots to Africa, but they're not quote-unquote pure. They've been hybridized, creolized. They've been transformed by the experiences that we've had in the mm-hmm. New World, a primary experience, of course, being enslavement and then emancipation. But Afro-urban magic speaks to the movement of Black people and what Dion Brand, a Canadian writer, calls the mastery of wayfinding.
The mastery of wayfinding.
Of wayfinding.
Wayfinding.
Wayfinding, that we find a way when there is no way. And that's partly what defines us. So that she takes the example of the folk story, the people could fly, that Africans, simply enslaved Africans, reached their limit and transcended, lifted themselves up and flew back to Africa. Or the idea of the North Star, that enslaved Africans in the Americas would look up and say, well, that's the North Star, and I don't have a map, and I don't have a car, I don't have a wagon, I don't have any of the normal means of transportation, but I will find a way to be free. So she talks about a mastery of wayfinding, and I thought, that is what my teenage characters are trying to do. They're trying to find a way to be free in the 21st century. And for Jenna, the 15-year-old protagonist, she thinks that means going to college. She's going to go to an Ivy League school and become a psychiatrist and kind of get away from the negative influences in her community. But her boyfriend, Judah, is Rastafarian, mm-hmm. and his sense of finding a way doesn't involve going to college. To him, being free, being full and complete means going back to Africa. The destiny of Black people is to return to Africa. So he's planning to get to Africa somehow, some way,
right.
and wants Jenna to want the same thing, but she doesn't. And then they get sent back in time together, and Jenna has to decide, is she going to try to find a way back to her life in Brooklyn, in the 21st century, or is she going to go with Judah to Liberia, right?
That's right?
Which way does freedom lie? Is it across the ocean to return to Africa? In 1863, what are her prospects like if she goes back to Liberia? And if she goes back to the 21st century, how does she open that door? How does she create a portal and pass back through the door that brought her into the past in the first place?
Yes, very, 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 very interesting. And, of course, we think about Octavia Butler.
Yes.
Kindred. And then you think Parable of the Sower with Lauren,
yeah,
you know,
Olamina.
Take Olamina. Mm-hmm. So just going back to, you chose 1863, and I always think, Octavia Butler may have chosen 1865, which was...
She's a little earlier.
A little bit
she's
earlier.
She's the antebellum period. Yeah, I think okay. it's around 1830s Maryland.
Okay.
I mean, her character returns to the past multiple times.
Right.
And it's over the course of Rufus's life. So I mm-hmm. think it's, but I think right. it
and for different reasons.
Too. He's always, you know, his life is in danger. And so
right.
Dana goes, not Dana, what's her name?
Dana.
It is Dana. She goes back in time to ensure that he lives long enough to rape one of her ancestors, right?
Well,
which is horrific.
And right.
To
horrific,
father her line.
But also to make sure that she
that
survives.
She can exist. So she,
right.
you know, in the tradition of Frederick Douglass's classic slave narrative, Dana becomes the witness and the participant.
Mm-hmm.
She has to watch what's going on around her, intervene to the point that it ensures her family line exists, but she ultimately has to offer up her own female ancestor to this rapist. You know, I mean, it's a horrific predicament, but she really makes clear that, you know, we like to think we would go back in time and go upside somebody's head if they ever tried
and
to.
The humbling
yeah,
experience,
it's extremely humbling.
Which is what Jenna Jenner experiences. So why did you choose 1863?
Well, a lot of things happened in 1863. On January 1st, we have the enactment of the Emancipation Proclamation, and that freed fugitive slaves from states that had seceded from the Union. So New York had already been abolished, had already abolished slavery since 1827. But there were so many fugitives living in New York State that that was a really critical moment for them to know that they no longer had to hide and flee, that they were free. So that's January 1st. And then in March, we have Lincoln issuing the Conscription Act. And then we have a kind of intensified debate over should black men be serving in the Union Army. They certainly want to, but whites are still concerned about having them armed. And then you have a lack of white soldiers, and you have resistance in New York City to the idea of the war itself. You know, working class white men, mainly Irish immigrants, are being manipulated by Democrat politicians who are saying, you know, you better watch out, because if you participate in this war, all these free blacks are going to flood north, and they're going to take your jobs, and they're going to take your women. And there was just, you know, there was anxiety, there was economic competition, and that turned into a disastrous situation in July of 1863 when the first draft happens, and then it's followed by a riot. So there were kind of those consecutive events happening within a six-month period, really, mm-hmm. that I thought would be dramatic for Jenna to kind of be that witness and participant, to get caught up in something mm-hmm. That a lot of people don't know about. You know, I studied racial violence in graduate school, and when I think of racial violence, I even think of the South primarily. But, you know, lynching happened all over the country, including Alaska. Mm-hmm. Racial violence in northern cities, there's a long history of that as well, and it's something we don't really talk about. The fact that Weeksville still exists, that you can still visit, there are still houses standing from that 19th century black community, that was important to me as well. So that made the Civil War period kind of ideal for me.
Right. And then you go back to just, I want to just follow up, is that really in order to write this novel, you had to really do a lot of research. And as you said, when you're teaching this novel, if we're using it in our classes or you're reading it, you really are getting a lot about the culture and what was happening. And mm-hmm. in fact, I think, I know that in my class, some students were not even aware that you had these riots in that time. So can you talk a little bit about your process for writing this mm-hmm. novel? What process did you go through?
Yeah, well, I think for me, a lot of the times, it's almost harder to write if I have too much historical data in my head. So I had to be careful about pacing myself, particularly in terms of the research. What was most important to me about the story, and as I'm working on the sequel now, the same applies, is that the story comes first. The story is more important than the history. Mm-hmm. And that, for some people, is difficult to accept because they think of my book as historical fiction, whereas it is historical fiction, but it's also speculative fiction. So I start with that little kind of preamble that says, I am not a historian. Mm-hmm. So what I am doing is not the same project that a historian would engage in. And I don't have to have the same fidelity to the historical record. So on the one hand, I know from my research in graduate school, the historical record is incomplete. There are a lot of voices that never got heard, that never had a chance to tell things from their perspective. I know that when I talk about something like lynching, say, I have to say this is the number of documented cases, because all the undocumented cases, you know, are still in the bottom of the Mississippi or wherever. So I know that the historical record is not necessarily complete. I know that there has been bias against women, against black women, if we look at historiography. And then I know that I'm writing fiction. So the most important thing to me was to create a compelling story with the characters that became very near and dear to me. And then I needed parameters. I needed historical parameters. So there actually, to my knowledge, aren't really that many books on Weeksville. I think there might be one.
I don't know of any.
That came out recently, mm-hmm. Crown Heights in Weeksville. And that means that I needed to take what I knew and use that parameter to kind of set up a fence. And then within the space inside the fence, I could do whatever I wanted. And I did take some liberties. I knew that Weeksville had an orphanage, the Howard Orphanage, and I believe it was built in 1866. Now, my book takes place mm-hmm. in 1863, so I moved things up a little bit.
But it's what speculative fiction.
Right, it does. It asks, what if? What if this happened? What if that happened? The New York City draft riots did spill over into Brooklyn. There were blacks targeted, especially along the East River. There's no documented evidence that it spilled over into Brooklyn Heights. But I thought, what if? Brooklyn Heights was the neighborhood where you had wealthy white, predominantly Republicans who supported the Union. So it seems likely to me that a mob would head there if they were looking for targets, because wealthy Republicans were targeted during the riots. So I find that with all the historical research that I do, probably 20% of it ends up in the book. You do a whole lot of research, mm-hmm. but you don't let it dominate the narrative. Mm-hmm. The story has to come first. And Barbara Christian said, you know, that knowing the historical record frees you from it.
Right.
And I feel like that's what I try to do, is know what happened and then step back and do what I need to do.
Right. The story first, the reader first. You know, we're coming, believe it or not, we've been talking a lot and we're coming to a close. One of the things, as you know, that we hold at the college is the National Black Writers Conference. And some people will ask, well, why do you need a conference? Why do you need it? And I think you alluded to it when you talked about our stories don't get told, and how the kinds of books you're writing in Bird and A Wish After Midnight ends up telling that story. Can you talk a little bit about that as we come to a close? What do you see, what do you think is the role of conferences such as the National Black Writers Conference?
I actually just wrote an essay on white privilege within the publishing industry, and I think people honestly don't realize the extent to which the industry is so homogeneous, and it just is not as diverse a space as people like to think. The arts are wonderful. The arts should be all about a chorus of distinct and diverse voices. But when it really comes down to platforms and spaces, promotional spaces, if you go to a quote-unquote mainstream conference, you'll be lucky if you find two or three people of color included in the programming, included in the organizing. Someone else is setting the agenda and someone else is directing the conversation. And you can't expect that your priorities will be their priorities. When we have our own space, when we create our own agenda, when we create an environment that is welcoming and that appreciates diversity and distinct voices. I mean, it's not as though we're all sitting around like it's preaching to the choir. There's a lot of dissent and debate. It's an opportunity for us to invoke our own tradition. A lot of people who are in the arts today don't actually know that there is a long tradition of black people writing and expressing themselves and being creative. Mm-hmm. But we know that, and we can have a conversation that is rich and deep and that resonates with us in a way that it perhaps doesn't with others.
Okay. So we are going to have to wind up. I want to thank you for coming. I want to encourage our listening audience to support Zetta Elliott's.
Oh, thank you.
And to purchase and read. It's a wonderful novel. Sometimes you would think young adult, but it really crosses genres, I mean, age groups. It's also an adult novel. Wish After Midnight, a novel. And also this wonderful book, Bird, which is, I said, the winner of a number of awards. And really, really a compelling story about a young boy and the relationships and the struggles he goes through and his survival in the urban city. So thank you very much. And you can get these at your local bookstore.
Absolutely. And your independent bookseller, your library, big chain stores, everywhere.
Okay. Thank you so much. And to our listening audience, thank you for tuning in. Remember, the writer is always reading. The reader is always writing. Keep reading and writing. Write me at writers@mec.cuny.edu and come back next week. This is Dr. Brenda Greene signing off.
Next song was inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes. I'm sure most of you have heard of Langston Hughes. And he wrote a poem about rivers. And we call this song, I've Known Rivers.